Christ is risen.
He is risen.
Hallelujah. This is the seventh Sunday of Easter, our final Sunday in the Easter celebration, that we will be saying this, Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. I hope you remember it throughout your weeks, in the weeks ahead to come, in the months ahead, and remember that every Sunday is a little Easter for us because Christ rose on Easter Sunday morning. So as we finish out our Easter season, next week then means we move into Pentecost and the coming of the Holy Spirit for the disciples and for us, and reminding us that the Holy Spirit is with us always as we walk on this path, on this life in earth, on earth. And so we remember today, and we'll say it several more times as we finish out this Easter season, this Easter acclamation. So good to have all of you gathered here this morning in our Lord's house as we continue that Easter celebration for this, the final Sunday, but also as we gather to praise and thanks God for all of the blessings he's given to us, especially the gift of his son, Jesus. With that, we begin with our opening hymn, A Hymn of Glory, Let Us Sing. Worship folder is printed out for you, is also up on the overhead.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
The righteous shall be glad. They shall exult before God. They shall be jubilant with joy. Rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God. In repentant faith, we come before the Lord in confession. Almighty God, merciful Father, we who are by nature sinful and separated from you, confess our sinfulness. We have sinned in our thinking of only of ourselves, not others, by saying words that hurt, not heal, and our actions that do not show love, but indifference. How often we have failed to cast our anxieties on you. How often we forgive us for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord has compassion and says, "Do not weep." In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thanks be to God. We join in singing our hymn of praise. Let us pray. King of glory, Lord of hosts, you are uplifted in triumph far above the heavens. We pray, do not leave us without comfort, but send us the promised Spirit of truth, that in him we may be one. You live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Our first reading for this, the seventh Sunday of Easter, comes from the book of Acts, chapter 1. Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. And when they had entered, they went up to the upper room where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. All these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. In those days Peter stood up among the brothers, the company of persons was in all about 120, and said, "Brothers, the scriptures had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allowed his share in this ministry. Now this man bought a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle and all his bowels gushed out. And it became known to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so that the field was called in their own language a keldama, that is, field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, 'May his camp become desolate, and let there be no one to dwell in it, and let another take his office.' So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day that he was taken up from us, one of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection." And they put forward Joseph called Barsabbas, who was also called Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, "You, Lord, who know the hearts of all, show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle reading for today comes from 1 Peter chapter 4. "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or as a meddler. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. For it is time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be dominion forever and ever. Amen." This is the word of the Lord. We stand for the reading of our Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 17th chapter. When Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all flesh, to give eternal life to all you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. I have manifested your name to the people whom you gave me out of the world. Yours they were, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything that you have given me is from you. For I have given them the words that you gave me, and they received them, and have come to know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you have sent me. I am praying for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. And I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. This is the gospel of the Lord. We now confess our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with his Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated as we join in singing Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Our text for our meditation today comes from our gospel reading of John 17, was read a few moments ago from the lectern, Dear Friends in Christ. Most of us at one time or another in our lives have cheered desperately for a team. Whether that team was a professional or a collegiate team or even a high school team out there, whether it was baseball, football, basketball, soccer, whatever, we all can probably name that one team we lost our heads over. For a lot of people in Nebraska, it would have to be considered Cornhusker football, right? Although the past few years haven't been so good, but that's the team in Nebraska that we sometimes lose our head over. When we think back to that special team, we may be able to recall a strange relationship that developed when our team was successful. We tend to receive some of the glory, don't we? We like to have some of that glory. Oftentimes it says, wow, your team is doing really, really well this year. Maybe this year you guys are going to go all the way with your team, kind of like what the Chicago Cubs did back in 2016 when they won the World Series. We receive glory for the success of our team as though we were out on the field or the court playing the game ourselves along with all of those people on that team. We are receiving glory for something we have absolutely nothing to do with. Glory we certainly don't deserve, right? Yet the undeserved glory that we receive is returned to the team. We cheer for them, don't we? We oftentimes pay money to go see the teams play. We buy their merchandise, right? The caps, the t-shirts, or that big annoying foam number one finger that's out there, all in order to spread the glory for the team. We can't wait to glorify the team by telling someone about our team's most recent victory. Our God, our Heavenly Father, has been very successful. He has created a beautiful world in which we live. He sustains and he provides for us, and he provides for his world each and every day. He sent his one and only son, Jesus, into our world of sin to live, to suffer, to die, and then to rise again for the forgiveness of sins and the promise of life everlasting by grace through faith in Jesus. Our God is certainly a winner. Through the blessings of our gracious God, we too are also winners. We are allowed to share in his glory. In baptism, God glorifies us then by making us his very own through water and the word. We share in the glory of God when we confess our sins before God, our Heavenly Father, and find forgiveness there as well. We share in the glory of God when we read his word and we remember his promises of love and deliverance for all people. We share in the glory of God when we partake of the Lord's Supper, as we are again privileged to do here today, eating and drinking his very body and blood in with and under the bread and wine, shed for us on that cross, given for us on that cross, for the forgiveness of all of our sins. God has allowed us through faith to share in his glory. We in no way have earned or deserve that glory. But God, our Father in heaven, loves us so much that he gives it to us anyway. 1 Peter 2:9 says it this way. He says, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Take time each and every day of your life to bask in that undeserved glory of God. Since God has allowed us to share in his glory, we want to return that glory back to God. Jesus tells us in the Gospel of John that he will no longer be in the world, but that we are still in the world. Remember that Jesus has already assured us that we have another counselor besides him by our side, the promised Holy Spirit. And he's told his disciples this will be happening. And that takes place next week as we celebrate Pentecost. Now he prays that the Father will also protect his own while they are in the world. That all being assured, we are left in the world to do what? If we're assured of all this, what are we supposed to do? Well, we are to give the glory back to God. And how do we do that? We give the glory back to God, our Heavenly Father, as Jesus said in Philippians 2, or as Jesus did. Philippians 2 tells us this way, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. And Matthew 28:20 tells us, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. We give glory back to God, our Heavenly Father, by receiving His Word. We give glory to God by receiving the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We give glory to God by telling others about our Savior, Jesus Christ. We give glory to God by serving our neighbors. The Bible tells us that Jesus did not come to be served, but to serve and to give His life as a ransom for many. We are what people see of Jesus in our world today. We are a reflection of His glory. The glory of God shines through our lives. It should be shining through our lives each and every day. And as the old saying kind of goes, would there be enough evidence to convict you of being a Christian, a follower of Jesus Christ? Do we reflect God's glory back? It is our responsibility then to be people of the light. People of the light of the glory of Jesus in our world today. People are going to look at each and every one of us as we call ourselves Christians and disciples of Jesus to see how we deal with other people. How do we treat others, especially those who are closest to us? People notice how we respond when someone has done us harm and wronged us. People notice how we respond to a crisis in our lives, and hopefully as we respond to that, we rely on Jesus and it shows through, and they ask, how are you getting by? In all that we do and in all that we say while we live out this life here on this earth, we want to reflect the glory of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. However, we reflect the glory of our Lord best when we don't try to reflect perfection, which is impossible for us. We reflect the glory of the Lord the best when we reflect forgiveness. We joyfully and thankfully receive the forgiveness of God, our Heavenly Father, and then without hesitation, we pass that same forgiveness on to others within our lives. When we leave this world, God will fully glorify us with Him forever in heaven. There we will finally see and fully partake of the glory of the Lord and of our God and Father in heaven, not as a reward for how good we've been, because we are not, but as a promise, an eternal inheritance given to all believers in Jesus Christ. Until that day, we pray that God would use us to glorify His name in this world and in all that we say and do. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which goes beyond all human understanding, keep our hearts and minds in true faith in Christ Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. We stand for prayers. This is the confidence that we have toward Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And if we know that He hears us in whatever we ask, we know that He will have granted us the request that we ask of Him. Trusting in this promise, then, we come to our Lord in prayer. Lord, in Your mercy. Holy Father,
Keep us in your name, the name you have given each and every one of us in holy baptism, that we may be one, even as you and your Son Jesus are one. Lord, in your mercy. Holy Father, guard us and keep us that we may not be lost, and keep us from the evil one, from the snares and wiles of the devil. Lord, in your mercy. Grant to us joy, Holy Father, the full joy that comes from knowing you and loving you. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, continue to give us your word, the word that is truth, and sanctify us in that truth. Although hated by the world, we are loved by you. Send us, Lord, into the world to be light and salt, witnesses of your grace and love. And although sent into the world, keep us from being of the world, conformed to its patterns. Rather, help us be transformed by your word. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Heavenly Father, our guide and our protector, we thank you for all the students who have graduated or will be graduating in our town, in our local schools and high schools, in our local universities, at Christ Lutheran School and Lutheran High Northeast. Thank you for directing them in their studies with wisdom and excellence. Bring to their remembrance your love in Christ and your purpose for each and every one of them, as the prophet Jeremiah wrote, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope." Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we pray for the needs of this congregation, knowing you will hear us, for the sick and the infirm, for those who suffer in body or soul, spirit or emotion, for the bereaved, for the lonely, for the troubled, we pray your peace, your joy, your patience. Lord, in your mercy. We pray in confidence, knowing that you will hear whatever we ask according to your will, so we pray, your will be done, in the name of Jesus our Savior. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God. And most especially are we bound to praise you on this day for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and bore the sins of the world. By his dying, he has destroyed death, and by his rising again, he has restored to us everlasting life. Prepare us joyfully to remember our Redeemer and receive him who comes to us in his body and blood. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which was shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Please be seated. Thank you.
We stand. And now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in true faith until life everlasting. His peace be with you, we pray. Grant, O Lord, that we who have tasted that you are good, as you have given us to eat and drink of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus, may continue steadfast in the true faith, that we may one day taste the eternal goodness of life with you in heaven. You are Lord forever. Amen. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. You may be seated as we sing our closing hymn. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. It's so good to have you all here again this morning, especially as I said, we're ending our Easter season now and moving into the Pentecost season. Next week, we'll deal with Pentecost, the coming of the Holy Spirit, and you'll hear about that in our lessons as the Holy Spirit descends upon the disciples there and also comes to us today. And as you go about your walk with the Lord today, remember that it's all been done for us, and we share in that glory of Jesus Christ and of the Father. And in return, we reflect that glory back to the Father, but also reflected it back by going out and sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with others. Have a great rest of the week with the Lord. I'll see you in the back.